awesome. Should be me live now. So feel free to start asking questions and so on. I'm just sending out stuff via social media. Did not mean to have that there. So yeah, just feel free to ask questions in the chat box. Well, I actually get back to the page. Video dashboard, where is that? Video manager. Here we go. It's all good, it should be working. First question, are you active on the fractal board? No. Probably should do. Like, I do plan on uploading patches for the stuff I've been using on the new album, on Axe Exchange anyway. So yeah, I'm generally not that active on most forums. I generally just shitpost on social media. Okay, cable management. My cable management's still terrible. It's a mess of wires underneath my our computer. So I'm just sending out a tweet. How in the world your name is pronounced? Yeah, so the way I tell people to pronounce it is Sithu. So my first name is pronounced Sithu, and my last name is pronounced A. So it's Sithu A. Any tips for improving legato technique? So actually, I do have a guitar, so I'll just plug myself in. I can sort of do a live sort of lesson as well. Let me just turn my sound on. Yeah. Cool. So techniques for improving legato. Let me just have it so you can actually see my guitar as well. Hopefully that's better. Trying to think now. Legato, I guess, it's one of those things where it's just consistency, like trying to get the same sort of pressure, sort of. Just trying to get the same timing, so like if you're playing something like a. Like playing along to a metronome, making sure that those note divisions are fine, that you know you're getting the same consistency of pressure through the notes. I mean, it's probably easier to hear on a clean patch. So if I was alternate picking something. Just trying to make sure that's all consistent, like timing wise, pressure wise. And if you want to, like, then you can add that extra level of control where you can actually adjust the pressure to sort of accent certain notes. Like, so yeah, I guess those are some ideas for legato. Favorite cab IRs at the moment? To be honest, I kind of just throw stuff on my. On my Axe FX, I just kind of forget exactly everything I use. So I don't know what exact cab IRs I use. I can look them up. I can fire up Axe Edit and see what I actually use in my main chain. So if I go to my lead patch, the cabs I'm using are the 4x12 rectifier with an SM57, which ironically I'm using a different mic, using a UA7 condenser and AX edit, and a 4x12 solo V12. I don't know exactly what those are, they just sounded good to me, so those are what I use. Opinions on the Shima, cool guys, friends with all the guys on the Shima, and they I gigged with them in Glasgow, so really cool guys, good people to know. What are your favorite parts processes of the upcoming album without giving any secrets away? So what I really like about what I've done so far is I really feel that I've it's all very new, it's all very different. I feel like the stuff, people are going to be sort of surprised by some of the stuff I'm doing. And it's also, you know, I'm trying to be as prog as possible. So lots of long songs, lots of sort of 8-minute long songs. And then the second half of the, so there's going to be a double album, the second sort of disc, so you will, it's going to be one long song as well, where I feel that the songs I've got in the first half are very sort of, you know, diverse and different. But I've sort of had to, for the second half, even do something more different. So hopefully, you know, there's enough on there to say, you know, people can look back on stuff I've done and say, yeah, we know that's sort of C2 style, if there is one. But also sort of say, well, I've not heard this from him, or this is new and this is fresh. And considering my last EP was a shitpost anime EP, I think, you know, having a good, you know, proper proggy second album, long album, it's going to be good. Hopefully people enjoy it. Notice me, Senpai. You have been noticed, Gent Spence. How do you deal with fret buzz when playing on clean patches? Fret buzz. I don't know, it's not... I don't really hear much fret buzz. I mean, I personally don't really have an issue with it, like... Yeah, I don't know, I didn't get it. Generally, like, I play with my strings, like, I've got quite a low string height, so there's probably a bit of buzz anyway, but, like, when you have that bit of buzz, you can you can get that, I'm gonna say it, you can get that genty tone. I think, like, having low strings and a little tiny bit of fret buzz adds to the sort of aggressive tone, aggressive sort of sound that you can get, and then you can get that nice sort of snappy, and get a nice sort of snappy sound to it. Any reasons for not the Duvel Elite? So this guitar is actually not an order, custom order from Mayo. I saw on the guitar, so Guitar are the UK distributor for Mayonnaise. Saw this on a website while at the tail end of a 4.5-hour train journey, and I got hit by the gas really, really hard. Some of you might have seen a post where I said I made a gas pact with one of my friends where instead of committing suicide, we commit financial suicide by buying a new guitar each. So I saw this and I thought, you know, I really quite fancy Duvel, and my friend said, I'll buy a Strandberg Bowden OS if you buy this Duvel. So we both respectively took the hit and bought new guitars. So this was the one that was just available. I think the only difference between the Duvel Elite and standard models is just the wood. So I think the Elites have a eye poplar top and different wood. It's got an ebony board. This has got a rosewood board. But hardware wise, they're exactly the same. You know, bridge pickups, hip shot locking tuners, split coil. So yeah, there's not like, I think, you know, you're getting different wood, and you know, it depends on how much of a tone wood guy you are, whether you believe, you know, it makes a huge difference, or whether you play an RCDs and think, you know, I like my guitars made out of plastic and tone woods is just, it's just a fad. But yeah, I'm, to be honest, they're like essentially same guitar, it's just different woods. So there's but the main reason I got this one is just because it was available and I wanted it there and then. Um, Have you come across ground loops in your signal due to Focusrite interfaces? So I did have a ground loop, but that was just because of really, really bad wall power in my flat. So one of the easiest ways to deal with a ground loop is to get a power conditioner and just plug everything that's going to be used for audio through that power conditioner. So you can get a decent one through Amazon. I got one for about 30 quid. I plugged all my PC, my XFX, my Focusrite interface through it. So that took care of the ground loop and I didn't hear anything through my studio monitors. It was really, really annoying. It was really bad when I was playing video games actually through the interface. Like the ground loop would just buzz at me. I was playing The Witcher 3 and I think it was louder than the game audio. So yeah, I had to get that to fix it. But yeah, no ground loop issues since getting a power conditioner. It's the easiest, quickest way to fix that. What tuning are you using? So on strings, I generally tune to drop D. Or standard. I don't go any lower than that. I do occasionally go to half step down, so standard E flat or drop C sharp or drop D flat, depending on where in the circle of fifths you are. But yeah, I generally go for drop D. On seven strings, I go for drop A flat. So. The same sort of tuning that I think the reason I use it is when I was a young impressionable guitarist, I thought, yeah, I'll tune to drop A flat because that's what Periphery did. And I could just kind of stuck with it. So. So yeah, drop A flat for the seventh string. Well, the second part of that question was, is there a favorite song on the one split with Pliny? I mean, it's a weird one. I mean, I love Pliny songs in it. So the way that we did that was we never actually spoke to each other in person. We just gave each other Facebook messages and said, you're going to write two songs. I'm going to write two songs. And then at the end of it, we did guest solos in each other's songs. We got Jakub and David Maksymiecicz. Jakub Zjateki and David Maksymiecicz did the solos on that, on each of our tracks, and then we just sort of put that together and released it. So, and I really like, especially after learning to play, I really like Rupture. That's a really fun song. For my own stuff, I guess, sorry, I keep dropping my pick. I'm surprised I can find it. For my own stuff, I guess Solstice is a fun one, just because of how fun the riff is, that lead line there. And like I like that little line because I'm using the flat second, which isn't really in the scale, but it's if you play it quick enough, you get this. Yeah, and it was cheesy leads and stuff. Before Polyphia, we're doing cheesy leads. Not that there's anything wrong with cheesy leads. Senpai EP is just an EP of cheesy leads. Were you able to pick up that laptop? I don't know what you're talking about. You mean if I wanted to get a new laptop? So yeah, yeah. Grab myself a MacBook Pro because I just wanted something different. So I could say that I'm a pure tech agnostic. So I use a desktop PC with Windows, use a MacBook as a laptop, and use an Android phone. So I'm pretty much all over the place in terms of tech. Yeah, I'm gonna take that to Japan. It's gonna run the interface and the live sort of backing tracks and stuff. Heard you say that most of the people you work with don't really know you, what you do musically. What's your experience with showing them what you do, and have they ever saw the madness of you on Facebook? At my current job, which I'll be leaving before going on tour to Japan, didn't really mention music. It doesn't really come up. Working a corporate job and telling people that you do instrumental progressive metal music on the side is kind of not really the conversation opener that you start with. But occasionally, you know, people sort of started asking about it, you know, people would bring up guitar and I'd mention it in passing. And it's just, so I think most people are, you know, I think it's cool that that's what I'm doing. And, you know, they're pretty cool with the fact that I'm leaving the firm, not to join like a rival firm or go into industry, but, you know, to pursue something that I want to do. It's just, it just gets really awkward when Senpai gets brought up, because trying to explain, you know, why you drew anime girls playing prog and being late for school and having like things like having toast in mouth and all the, basically anything to do with Senpai, it's just, it's just a difficult thing to explain to anybody. And I'd rather not. Well, I mean, the world knows I'm a massive weeb anyway, so I guess there's no point hiding it anymore. Are you going to do a playthrough live in this webcast? So I won't be doing a playthrough, but what I'll be doing is, if anybody has any sort of guitar technique related questions, what I'll be doing is I'll try and try my best to show stuff. So for instance, someone was asking before about legato, so I tried my best off the top of my head to sort of come up with some ideas for improving legato. Most people, I mean, the stock response is just practice with a metronome and, you know, make sure pressure and stuff is, like that is consistent. So yeah, I will be talking about different aspects of guitar playing as we go along, as people ask. Free amp plugin recommendations. Definitely Lepo Legion. When I started, this was pre the days of stuff like Bias FX and stuff. And, you know, I didn't have the money as a university student to get an Axe FX. I started using Lepo Legion with some Mesa Boogie and Marshall cabinet impulse responses. So I used that, and I've been using them ever, like up until Senpai EP. Everything before then was used, all the sort of distorted and lead tones was with Lepo Legion. So you can really do a lot with free plugins. So it's one of those things where it's a very much the exception to the rule of, you know, you get what you pay for. I mean, those plugins are really exceptional for free ones, and they're really versatile. And, you know, if you get the right, if you get like a Tube Screamer plugin, compressor, noise gate, run that in front, get some good cabinet responses, IRs, then you can, you know, do quite a lot with it, get some really nice sounds. What bands, artists, or music in general are you currently listening to? That's a good question. I feel like I've not really been listening to a lot of music. I've been listening to a lot of my own because, that, you know, I've been full-time recording. I think the last thing I listened to was the Kurt Rosenwinkel's album. I can't remember what it's called. But, you know, he's a really good example of, like, I'm just looking it up, what the album's called. Kurt Rosenwinkel. He's a jazz guitarist, by the way, modern jazz guitarist. What was the album I was listening to? The Next Step, from 2001. So he's a really good example of like a modern jazz player where it's just like 3-3-5 me. Like, I don't really understand a lot of what's going on, but it's fun to listen to. Are you doing music full time? No, not at the moment. But I will be going into music full time. That's just, it's sort of, I've gotten to a point where I think, you know, I can be happy. I can pay rent. I can pay bills, from sort of music money. So I'd rather be doing that full time as opposed to doing a corporate job where I'm, you know, the main thing about my job that I just really struggled with was traveling. So for the first 2 months of the year, I had to take a 4.5 hour train journey every Monday and every Thursday back home to Glasgow, working at a client in Leeds, and like hotel rooms are the worst places to do anything. Like, even if I brought a guitar and an interface, like I just could not do anything. And obviously, like, my main rigs here, I can't bring my Axe FX down a train with me every week. So that's the main reason. Just like that kind of travel is horrible for what I do. I mean, the other option was to try and get another job where travel wouldn't be an issue. But I just thought, you know, I might as well make a go of it at least and see if I can do this music full time thing. So that's where I'm at. I own an RGE1527. Worth it to trade for a Devel? I don't know where you're going to get a one-to-one trade, to be honest. This guitar, this Develle, the standard at least, was, three times as much cost of the RG1527, although I did buy mine back in 2007, so that's nearly 10 years ago. I wouldn't know. It depends. Like the RG1527's got the, and I still have mine sitting over there, my guitar rack. It's got the sort of Ibanez locking trem. So you sacrifice that for a fixed bridge. I mean, like my standard phrase about floating trems is the best thing about a floating trem is that it's, a floating trem. The worst thing is that it is a floating trem. They come with their advantages and disadvantages. So fixed bridge is definitely simpler. In terms of niceness to play, I guess, well, I mean, like Mayo guitars, you can't really go wrong with them in terms of like build quality, niceness to play. I mean, if you can get a good deal on it, then maybe. Just depends on what you want. I don't want to give sort of a solid recommendation either way because it's your instrument and I can't really I don't really know what your sort of use case is. But I mean, Duvel's lovely instrument. Although I do like my 1527, I've had it for years, so it's a lot of sentimental value. Favorite animes right now. Probably I can't remember its full name. It's called Erased on Crunchyroll. What's its full name? Boku Dake ga Inai Machi. It's a sort of time travel anime. It's really good. The other one is called Konosuba, which is like a sort of fantasy anime, but it's just really funny. They take the piss out of everything. It's and like I think it's a British thing where we like watching people who are miserable and hating life. I really quite enjoy that. So that's called Konosuba. How do you compose and develop your ideas of the song? So pretty much what I do, what I'm doing here. So I'll have a guitar in front of me, and I'll be like, I want to write a riff, and then think, I think, yeah, that's a really cool, shitty melody, and then I'll, develop that and, play some chords along with that. So, be like, And then, like, I'll just build it from there. So, I write and record as I go. So, I can come up with a riff and I record that, and then I will immediately sort of think, okay, I've got this riff recorded, what's the next part? So my sort of songwriting process tends to like bring out linear songs where there's not like a set sort of verse chorus first chorus structure. It can be rather linear, or there'll be parts of the song which don't repeat at all. It also means that as I write, I'll be like, okay, these sections I've written, I want to keep them, but it would be cooler if this comes before that, or the ordering should be different. So I do switch around sort of structure elements because of the way I write. So yeah, I just sit in front of a guitar, see what comes to mind, and record from there. Which IRs do you recommend? I think I answered something like this before. How many times does it take you to record mix master? How much time? Depends totally on the song. Like 26, that EP I did in 3 days. Isles EP I did in 2 weeks. Then the universe took me 3 months. It just depends. Each song is different. Each release is different. My current album, like some of the songs I've been working on for at least a year, just but because of work, I've just not had the time to really flesh it out. And Senpai EP was sort of one of those things where I had the time to quickly, do an EP like that, because I really wanted to dedicate a lot of time to this album. So it just depends, like, but I mean, like, if I was sitting down and writing a song, I could probably, do it in about 12 hours. And stuff I put on SoundCloud, like that cover of that Snail's House song I did, it probably took about 8 hours to do. So. It can be very quick, but it can also be, take ages. Considering that you use an Axe FX, what do you think about tube amp fanatics? I mean, like, to be honest, if I could do it, if I could have like a huge tube amp rig with loads of pedals and if I could, have that as my main rig, I think I would do it because it's cool. There's a sort of throwback to, 80s sort of hair metal where you've got walls and Marshall cabs and stuff like that. I think it's a cool image, and if you get that to work, then that'd be great. And they do sound great, but I mean, for what I do, where, you know, going to Japan, how do you even think about taking a rig like that with you? So I definitely think there's a lot of merit to tube amps, and like I'd like to get one, but you know, I kind of spend my money on guitars instead. So for me, like my personal sort of use case of, you know, needing, you know, something quick and portable with a lot of very different sounds. I mean, like I'm very anal. Like I, in between different tracks, I'll have the delays set to tempo of the track, sort of a quarter note or like a quarter beat. I'll have the delay, like I go as far as to set the delays differently. And I go as far as to changing the gain on clean patches, whether I'm using my Strat or not live. So I just like having that level of control with the Axe FX really helps. So for me, it's, you know, why I prefer it. Would you do a guest solo on someone's first EP ever? I think I have. I think I've done guest solos on people's first releases. I'm a bit burned out from sort of doing guest solos recently. So I'll probably take a wee break, especially since I'm recording. But I think once I sort of start doing music full time, I'll probably have more time to actually do guest solos. I don't ask for money for guest solos, but for me, it's kind of like, do I dig the music? Do I think my style, you know, works? So if it's like, you know, if someone sends me like, you know, just huge like deathcore, just. They sent me like something horrible on deathcore, I'm just like, I don't know if I can solo. Although then again, I have done solos on a deathcore, sort of more deathcore style release. So it just depends on whether, you know, I personally vibe with the music and I think, you know, it's a good project to, you know, put my name behind and do a solo for. Do you have Progressive Foundry from Superior? No, I don't. So what I bought the Metal Machinery expansion literally days before Progressive Foundry was announced. So I got that instead, and that's what I've been using. But I mean, I really like the sounds that I got with Metal Machinery, and I think what I do is I use sort of mainly Metal Machinery samples, but I mix them in with kit pieces like from Avatar. So like for Metal Machinery, I think the snares are kind of crap. So I sort of double them up with an Avatar snare, and I like some of the cymbals from Avatar, so I chuck them in. But I, you know, I really like the sounds out of Metal Machinery, and like it's a sort of almost common complaint where you see sort of people saying, you know, this sounds really superior, like the drums sound like superior, and people can sort of straight off notice that that's superior drummer. So I'm trying to get away from that and have my drums sound a bit more authentic. And like it's I've gotten quite far with the template, the setup I have for superior drummer with Metal Machinery. Like I have a full on jazz track, like Pat Metheny style inspired jazz track on the new album. Lots of piano and stuff like that on there, and literally just took the drums and down the velocities, and it sounds quite convincing actually. So that's, I find that really cool. Lepo Legion is the plugin. Yep. What time signature, key signatures do you use when writing your songs? So scales are key signatures. To be honest, like I'm pretty much almost always in like the minor scale. So like, you know, just. But like I try to use a lot of chromatic stuff. So yeah. And to be honest, like you can get a lot of, you know, you can get a lot of traction with the pentatonic scale. So you know, just you. You get a lot of the pentatonic and minor. So that's generally where I am. Key signatures again, almost always minor, but I do like little sort of subtle modulations. So if I'm playing, you know, something in D. Playing like, you know, a minor chord there instead of a major chord, you know, gives it quite a cool feel. So, yeah, little things like that. I think it's mainly minor, but like you know, throwing little things, throwing little modulations, and I think that gives it a cool vibe. Makes it sound a little bit different from just your standard sort of minor key. Will you be checking out Carson Carvin Kiesel guitars at any point? I'm not sure. I mean, you know, when I played my sort of 7-string male, like I kind of found it in terms of guitars. Like I just like that, it sort of set a benchmark to me, which I compare all the guitars with. I tend not to want to buy any guitars unless I try them. This was an exception, but I guess I was sort of gassing hard for Duvel. Like I was able to actually play that 7-string Mayo before I bought it, so you know that sort of set me sort of thinking, yeah, exactly, this is exactly what I want. So I'd want to try one before I buy it. I mean, I got the chance to try an Aristides the other day and sort of, you know, got to experience that. So it's definitely something I want to try out before I sort of think I want to buy a guitar. I've heard good things about them, but you know, as much as you know, internet hype and so on, I do actually want to try them. Speaking of the UK, how do you deal with the monotony of living in Scotland other than participating in spicy webcasts? So I live in Glasgow, which is one of the biggest cities in the UK. So monotony is not a word I associate with Glasgow at all. It's there's a lot to do here. If you love seeing gigs, Glasgow is your city. I've seen so many bands in Glasgow, you know, all the usual suspects like Tesseract. I recently saw Tesseract and Contortionist, seen Monuments, seen Carnival, seen Meshuggah, seen Animals as Leaders. Seen Periphery a couple of times. I've seen Dream Theater back, you know, before they're releasing the same album over and over again. So, yeah, Glasgow is probably one of the best places to be in Scotland, if not the UK. It's one of my favorite cities, to be honest. And I'm going to be seeing Tricot next Friday. So, lots to do. Do you have a preset for just the Avatar kit? If you do, would you want to share? I do actually have a preset for the Avatar kit. I actually uploaded one onto Dropbox on my SoundCloud, so I'll just post a link to that in the chat if I can find it. Where is it? Yeah. So this is just using the Avatar kit and the built-in Superior plugins. Obviously, you'll want to adjust it for your own use, but it's probably a decent starting point. So, Superior Drummer Avatar preset. Thinking about improving my home recording gear, having an amp head, a money saver, two notes, torpedoes, stick with that or sell the head and gather the money for Axe FX. What's your advice? So for me personally, because I kind of get crazy ideas when I record, so I just want, you know, I want an octaver and I want sort of I want an octaver and I want, you know, heaps and heaps of reverb, and I want to be able to do that, like, you know, just like that. And like I've kind of been spoiled by using, you know, digital plugins where, you know, you can do that just at, you know, by the click of a button. So I, you know, it depends. You know, if you want the sound of that particular amp, then, excuse me, and you have the means to mic it up, then, you know, that's maybe what you should go for. But for me, you know, I the flexibility of the XFX is, you know, most important to me in the studio. And you know, if it's that flexible and you can get to say 99% the sound of a real amp, then, you know, I'd take that sacrifice, or like you say 95%, I'd take that 5% sacrifice to, you know, get that flexibility. How much of a gamer are you? How often are you gaming, and favorite games? So I have a PC with two GTX 980 Ti graphics cards, an i7 processor, and like 32 gigs of RAM. I'm a really, really big PC gamer. I've got a 120Hz monitor, a 144Hz monitor. So yeah, I absolutely love gaming. The game that's currently soaking up all my time is XCOM 2. I'm really enjoying, you know, having a 95% chance to hit something and missing, so that's good. So XCOM 2 has been my game at the moment. In terms of favorite games, I don't know, I find it really difficult to say, you know, what are my favorite games. I can very easily, you know, sit and name what I'm playing right now. So definitely, like I said, XCOM 2. What was I playing before that? I can't really remember, actually. I did go through a bit of a period where I wasn't really playing too much in the way of games, just because of, you know, recording and work. But yeah, XCOM 2 is my jam at the moment. The best weeb. There was a missed opportunity to call it the Wired Guitars Weebcast. Yes, I probably should have called it the Weebcast. Can you jam something? That's what I came here for. Don't know, I can play. I'm gonna be playing in Japan, so I've been practicing. Bit rusty. I'm not used to playing in front of the internet, but yeah, I'll be playing Biogenesis in Japan. I'll be playing some new songs as well. So yeah, we can jam something. What are your favorite pickups for basswood, ash, and mahogany? You see, I'm actually quite of a pickup noob, to be honest. Like, I very, very little sort of experience with all the pickups, because for, you know, before I got my Mayo, I've just been using stock guitar, stock pickups on all my guitars. So I still have the stock pickups on my RG1527, stock pickups on my Strat, stock pickups on my PRS. So the Mayo 7 string is the first time I played DiMarzio pickups. This is the first time I played Seymour Duncan pickups with this guitar. And when I played my friend's Aristides, that's the first time I played a bare knuckle juggernaut. So I'm probably the worst person to ask for pickup mahogany pickup recommendations, especially when it comes to sort of thinking about particular woods as well. So sorry, I can't really answer that question. What is your favorite guest solo in your discography so far? Hard to say. I've also done quite a few, and I've also done some for, I've done a few for stuff that hasn't been released, for stuff that hasn't been released yet. So that's a difficult answer to que difficult question to answer. Answer the question, God, I can't speak. Oh, in my discography though, I'm gonna say there's a couple of guest solos on my new album that are, one of them's just really good fun. It's just a really playful solo, and the other one's just like shreddy as shit ever. It's just like mouth. Like jaw-droppingly awesome, like stuff with a re sort of a good friend and a absolutely incredible guitar. So like, I can't wait to release it and have you guys hear some of the guest solos that people have done. How much have you been practicing recording, composing, and producing music before releasing your first album, Cassini? So, but by the time I re released Cassini, I'd been playing guitar for 9 years. Recording, I'd probably been doing that for at least a year. I sort of did some basic home recording beforehand, but nothing like with a proper DAW or anything like that. So I sort of properly started trying to record with a DAW and stuff back in 2009, 2010, and then I sort of started posting on the 7-string forums, which is, you know, where guys like Bulb, Misha Mansur, and you know, was posting his original demos. So back then it was really good to get, you got a lot of sort of good mix feedback and so on. So that's where I, you know, practiced a lot and would just come up with different mixes and would post there and various other forums and stuff. And then, you know, I saw, you know, Pliny's first EP as Halcyon, and I saw Cosmogenesis by Grew, which is still one of my sort of favorite albums, just because it sort of pushed me over the edge to do Cassini. So after I saw those back in 2011, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna, you know, release an album, I'm gonna record something. So yeah, probably about a year, been playing guitar for, like I said, 9 years before I did Cassini. Invent the universe or go home. Say something super inspiring. If a massive weeby nerd like me, who's always on the verge of being disowned by his parents for just being so disappointed in my life choices, can make it in music, I think anybody can. also joking about my parents, they're super supportive of everything I do. Are you giving Skype lessons? Yes, I will be giving Skype lessons. No sort of set time for when I start, although it'll quite possibly be, you know, in the next couple of weeks where I'll start giving out information. So if you sort of want to register your interest, I guess just firing a message on my sort of music Facebook page and I'll keep you in mind. But I'll be doing like a more formal announcement about when I'll actually start with the Skype lessons. Picks of choice. So I used to use the Tortex 3s, these things. But as you can see from the edges on them, they just wore down way too quick. So I've always liked Jazz 3s, but I found them too small until I realized, you know, you can get Jazz 3 XL. So these have been my picks of choice and they last forever. So I'm a big Jazz 3 XL guy at the moment. Do you collect anything other than guitars? Steam games. I have like 100 and something games on Steam, most of which I probably haven't even played. So I'm a collector of video games and Steam sales. Other things I collect, not really sure. I never really was much into, you know, collecting things or having stuff. My main hobby has always just been playing guitar or playing video games. I did recently buy an erhu, which is like a Chinese sort of traditional fiddle. So I might become one of those weird people who collects traditional instruments. If I get like a shamisen or some other traditional, I might get some. So I'm originally from Burma, so I might try and get some sort of Burmese traditional instruments as well. Any professional recording organized for your Japanese tour gigs, live stream video? Nothing professional that I know of. From my end, well, I'll be doing sort of like an informal tour diary. So I'll be taking the GoPro and some other camera gear with me to, you know, do some recording on my end. I'm probably going to film, you know, from our perspective, some stuff in the gigs. So I'll be taking like a headstock thing for the GoPro and taking some headstock footage, which should be quite fun. But apart from that, yeah, nothing too formal. I mean, like... I do want to document, you know, us just being prats in Japan. So one of the ideas is to take kilts with us, you know, to take that Scottish connection over to Japan. So the idea is to go around like Akihabara, which is like the nerdiest place in Tokyo, wearing kilts, you know, where people are dressed up as maids and cat girls and cat boys, and so on. You'll still manage to stand out wearing a kilt, so that'd be quite fun. Can you list some of your more obscure influences? Interesting one. So I guess in terms of like non sort of metal stuff, I'm a big fan of, I guess it probably wouldn't come as a surprise, I'm a big fan of Studio Ghibli and sort of Hayao Miyazaki films. So, you know, Joe Hisashi, the composer, is a big influence, at least sort of from a sort of inspiration viewpoint. Like, I love the way that he composes, so that's quite a big influence. Hiromi, the jazz pianist, is another big influence. I love the way that she sort of plays. She's a really sort of proggy, I guess, jazz pianist, so that's quite cool. And I guess, you know, probably, you know, from Senpai, if you can tell that, I get influenced by anime music. So I will, often what I'll do is be watching anime and there'll be like a cheesy melody and or some cheesy chords and I'll just be playing along with the guitar there. So I often get, sort of, I often and I'm subconsciously influenced by a lot of the sort of media I consume. What will you do with a physics degree and will you pursue a PhD and go into academia at any point? Well, the physics degree helped me get my current corporate job. So that was the tick box where it said you need X degree and X academic requirements to attempt to apply for the job. So that's what it's done. But no plans to go into academia. Probably wasn't smart enough to become a PhD student anyway. And like I didn't... Academia didn't really appeal to me because, you know, there's this culture of, you know, you got to be pushing out papers all the time. And as interesting as it could be, like, I guess, because my head was always in music, you know, I just wanted to figure a way to try and get into music. So, you know, I'd get the corporate job and, you know, get myself on my own 2 feet, away from, you know, needing to rely on parents for uni and stuff. And then once I did that, I could sort of figure out what's the best way to get into doing music. What are you listening to at the moment? I think I answered this before, mostly my own album, because I've just been working on that. I think the last thing I listened to was the Kurt Rosenwinkel album. The one thing I need to listen to is the remaster of Exoplanet by the Contortionist, because my brother's been telling me that I gotta listen to that. GoPro footage sounds pretty sweet. Yeah, it'll be fun. Like, I spent a lot of time in airports, and what I found is whenever I'm in airports, I just think, you know, I want to buy different bits of technology. So I bought a new a DSLR camera. I bought a couple of lenses. I bought the GoPro. Bought some Bose noise canceling headphones. So yeah, airports on me are bad in terms of like influencing me to waste my money on things that I probably don't need. But yeah, I got the GoPro, so it'll be fun for Japan. How much of a weeboo are you? So I don't have a Daki Makura pillow, although I do kind of want ProgChan ones to be made, which would be fun, although I don't want it to be of the hentai variety. But in terms of a weeboo, like, I'm very much a consumer of the media, so I watch a lot of anime, but I I don't own any anime watch, although I am wearing a One Punch Man t-shirt. So I do have sort of t-shirts with references to anime, but I guess that's as far as I go in terms of my weebiness. Sort of maybe nothing that my parents would disown me over, at least. Have you ever tried comparison guitars? I think so. I think I tried a comparison C2, which is, yeah, I think I wanted to try it because it was called a C2. Yeah, pretty good. I mean, like, I guess, you know, I've never seen anything that make me want to buy one, I guess. Have you seen Resurrection F? No, I don't know what that is. QWERTY, yeah, that's where I got the t-shirt from. I guess if there's no question, I'm just gonna randomly play guitar until someone asks a question. This is generally what what I do is I'll just sit down and noodle, so. Dragon Ball, the new movie. Didn't actually watch a lot of Dragon Ball as a kid, unfortunately. Like, I know of it, but, and I know that One Punch Man was definitely like a parody of anime, like Dragon Ball, but I never really watched a lot of Dragon Ball. What does your name mean? So I think Sithu, the Burmese pronunciation is Sithu, it's an old title for royalty in Burma. So like old kings used to have the title Sithu in front of their name. Now it's just like a regular Burmese name, but I think that's the meaning. It's like an old royal title. I don't actually know what my last name stands means. It's a pretty common sort of common word and phrase in Burmese, though. Looking forward to the new Periphery album. Yep, that'll be pretty cool. I think it'll be pretty interesting. Any formal music training? No, I'm self-taught. So, you know, my knowledge of theory and stuff like that, sort of my interpretation of actual sort of theory. So it's probably all wrong. But, you know, I can name the modes, and I can sort of talk about modulation and you know, talk about, you know, what the notes are, you know, first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and talk about, you know, minor 9, major 9, add 11 chords. So I like that. That's all sort of from my own musings, my own sort of investigations in the music and so on. But yeah, no formal music training. I'm self-taught. So I've got some bad habits. I've got what I call the Paul Gilbert pinky, where, you know, my pinky moves way too much. So. Yeah, my pinky moves way too much, so that's a really bad habit I've never been able to get rid of. And it's probably just a result of not having anybody to tell me your pinky's moving too much. You should maybe control that. What any songs that you learned and elevated your lead playing? Hard to say. Like, I learned so many songs when I was in high school. You know, improved my different aspects of my playing. Probably when I started playing tried to play Dream Theater songs. I think that's when I really sort of, you know, focused a lot more on the lead playing and like discovering, you know, prog and guys like Steve Vai and Paul Gerber. That's when I really sort of focused on it. So that I can't really point to a particular song, but I can definitely point to different artists who made me sort of want to go, you know, that's the style of guitar and music I want to be doing. And just speaking of Dream Theater, I was just sitting with a guitar and I started playing something. I just realized this was, I think, In the Presence Enemies. I just sort of accidentally re-stumbled onto that, which I found quite interesting. What was my first band? It was a band in high school. I think we were called Realign, and we were terrible. The great thing is that the guitarist in that band is my friend Martin, who's actually playing guitar with me live in Japan and played with me in Tech Fest. So, you know, it made long-lasting friendships from that band. I'm still friends with the bassist from that, really good friends with the bassist from that band as well. A friend of mine called Jack. And he's also, you know, working on music as well. So, yeah, I think the best thing about being in that first band was that I've made sort of friendships that have lasted well over 10 years. So that's really cool. What is your current job? I work as a technology management consultant. But I'm very junior, so it means that I'm mostly just a PowerPoint and Excel monkey. Mac or PC for music production? So I use a PC for music production, just because I also game on the same machine, so I want everything on the same. I've been using like Windows for ages as well, so it's the operating system I use for. I do have a MacBook, and I do have Logic Pro X on it. So I guess if I'm ever on the go, then I'd use the Mac for sort of on-the-go music production. So I'm not, main reason why I use the PC is just because I want the all-in-one machine for gaming as well. What bands are you listening to at the moment? I think I answered this as well, but the last bands I saw live were Tesseract and The Contortionist. I think that was really cool. I think there was a band called Nordic Giants on first. It was really cool. It was like audiovisual post-rock, so I found that really interesting. Favorite amp on the XFX? So the one that I use is Das Metal. Yeah, Das Metal. The tones on the new album and the current tones here. So all that's Das Metal, and then for cleans I use the Vibra King, so like a Fender amp style. I love sort of Fender style cleans where you can, you know, you get a little bit of extra breakup. So I quite like having, you know, I love that sort of Fender style clean, so that's what I go for on the Axe FX in terms of like what amps I use. Any 8-string on the new album? There's one 8-string song. I randomly bought a new Jackson 8-string because I was having issues with my RGA. So I bought a Jackson Dinky DKA-8. So I use that on the new album. So yeah, there is an 8-string track. Why did you pick the XFX over the Camper? I'm going to be honest, I didn't know what a Kemper was when I bought the Axe FX, and I needed to play live as well. So for me, the Axe FX was sort of the main thing, the main sort of choice. And again, like I said, I like the flexibility. Please like, comment, and subscribe. Yes, please do like, comment, and subscribe to the Wired Guitarist channel. Guys there are super cool. Also like, comment, and subscribe my channel as well. What are guitar tunings? I answered it before, but I'll just say it again. So on sixth string, I'm tuned to drop D. So I'll often use drop D or standard. I have a couple of songs in drop C sharp as well, so that's a half step down. On my seventh strings, I use drop A flat tuning, so that's a half step down with the seventh string tuned, drop tuned as well. Do you play your PRS often? I do. I really quite like it. I mean, I mainly bought it for the finish. I love the smalted maple finish. I'm just gonna go grab it. So I mean, like, look at that top. That's great. So yeah, I actually use this on a track on the new album. So you'll hear it on the new album. But yeah, I bought it mainly for the finish. I don't get on as well with the PRS as I'd like because the pickup selector's in a really awkward place, and I will flick my pinky out to switch pickups all the time. I find that a bit hard to get used to. And also, it's got a shiny finish. And after playing the Mayo, I realized that I really don't like shiny finishes. I much prefer a matte finish. It's the same issue with my Strat. My Strat is got a shiny finish on as well, which I'll just grab. Although, this is a really sort of special guitar to me. I'll be 10 years old now. I got it in 2006. It's got the 60th anniversary badge there. So yeah, I've had this Strat for a long time. I've used it on all my albums to date except Senpai. So it's got lots of dings and stuff like that. So as a good Strat should. So this is, you know, such a, I guess, a special guitar to me sort of sentimentally. But yeah, sort of things I struggle with this guitar is it's got a compound radius fretboard. So fretboard has more sort of radius, is more rounded at the high frets, which is really annoying because it kind of kills like 1.5 step bends and stuff. So when I played Shure, the Shure Super Strat sort of took care of that problem. But yeah, just thought I'd show off the Strat off since I was talking about the PRS. How do you prepare the Axe FX rig for touring? So I use the same studio tones as I do, except I probably take a little bit of the high end off my studio tones, and then I prepare different sort of patch sets for each song. So on the Axe FX foot pedal, you've got, you know, five selections. So what I'll do is I'll have, you know, different banks of five for every single song. And there won't really be that much difference. It'll be the same distortion tone. The main thing is just like cleans and lead tones will have the delays set to the tempo. So it'll be like a quarter note for the tempo that the song's at. And since we played that backing track, that'll be exact. The other thing I do is if there's any sort of particular patches that are unique to a song, I'll have that saved in that bank as well. Das Metal equals Diesel, VH4, Vibro King equals Fender, Vibro King. Yeah, thanks for that. Have you heard of Aristides instruments and what are your opinion of the instruments? Being on the music discussion group on Facebook, I have very much heard a lot about Aristides. I follow them on Instagram as well because I love the look of their guitars. So my friend Martin, who's playing in my band in Japan and played with me at Techfest, recently got an Aristides 070. So I got a chance to try that then. It was weird. It took a while to get used to. I think I'm too used to playing guitars made of wood. And obviously I compare everything to my Mayos. So it's really cool. Really interesting instrument. I don't know if I'd take the plunge and get one just yet, but I may be convinced after I saw like the seven string sort of Strat that Periphery got with the three single coils. And I thought that was a really cool idea. So. No, I may make the plunge with an Aristides. No plans to just yet, though. What are some guitarists of today's scene that you think are innovative, fresh? For me, it's you, Pliny, and Mark Holcomb. Big fan of Mark Holcomb's writing style. I think his writing style made me... I was writing the song Arrow Plus Nico's Adventure Over with him in mind, so that's a... that little interlude was to say that Arrow Plus Nico's Adventure Over from Isles EP was very much influenced by Mark Holcomb's playing, and that was before he was in Periphery, so that was sort of my hipster cred there back when, you know, he was in Haunted Shores. I think the I called the working title for that track Flaunted Whores, just to show how much on my sleeve I was wearing the Haunted Shores influence there. Everybody knows who Pliny is. The one guy I think is really quite cool, if you haven't heard of him, is a guy called Owain. He recently released an album which was sort of, I think it was ironically called Greatest Hits. So yeah, really sort of fresh, jazzy, jazz fusion kind of stuff. So definitely check out Owain if you get a chance. Someone who everybody might not have heard of, but I think definitely should. What are your thoughts on Polyphia? Extremely talented guys, really know how to sort of market themselves as well. I think a lot of people sort of say, you know, music is, you know, you do it for the love of it, and you know, that's true to a certain extent, but to really make it, you need to be business-minded, and they definitely are, for sure. I maybe haven't gotten much into their music as I would like to, but yeah, I'm digging the new stuff they're putting out, actually. It's nice that that they're evolving, and it's nice that they know exactly what they're going for with their music. So yeah, my thoughts on Polyphia. Don't know if you're endorsed by any guitar companies, but what brand would you choose for a signature guitar? Mayo. So I've got another Mayo coming on the way. So yeah, if I had to pick a signature, probably pick a Mayonnaise. I quite like a Duval with a Floyd Rose. I think because I kind of, since Pliny got his Strandberg with the tremolo, I was just thinking I kind of miss having a tremolo and being able to piss about with one. So a Duval with a tremolo would be cool. The other thing I'd really like is, they don't make 8-string Duvals, but if they made an 8-string Duval with a multi-scale neck, so, you know, with 25 and a half on for the high string and 27 for the 8-string, that'd be really, really cool. I find I don't get on with 8-strings as much as I'd like, because I just don't like playing leads on a 27 scale neck. So having that multi-scale would be really useful for me, and having, you know, the shorter scale length for the high strings. Oh wow, lots of questions there. String gauges. So I have weak girly fingers. So for my 6-strings, I use 9-42 for drop D. So this is a high 9, and again, it's basically because I like easily being able to do like... I like being able to do big bends, so yeah, I use 9-42s on my 6-strings. On my 7-strings, I use 10-56 for drop A flat. And a 56 is super, 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 super thin for A flat, but I don't care, YOLO. Do you find a Duval is snappy and a bit warmer sounding than a Regis? I guess they have different pickups, so it's difficult to compare, but like the Duval is a lot lighter, it's a lot sort of, it's a lot daintier, so playing it feels very different. It does feel a bit snappier. But like the Regis definitely is like chunky. So like I think it's good to have that as like a 7-string when you play like the gent stuff. It's more sort of it really sort of excels in that area. Although, I mean, I recorded Senpai EP with Aregis, so, and that had some nice sort of playful leads on it, so. Yeah, I think they're versatile enough that you can kind of use them for anything. It's just, I think the main difference is just in feeling. Like I said, this probably weighs about a third of the weight of the Regis. Which instruments can you play, not the Erhu? I can't claim to play Erhu. That'd be an affront and incredibly offensive to all the actual Erhu players out there. I only play guitar and bass. I'd love to be able to play piano, but again, I've probably reached that stage where it's just way too much effort to try and learn. Although, I guess that's negative talk. So I'd love to be able to play piano. I guess if you could call programming drums an instrument, I spend a lot of time on my drum programming, and I used to, when I started out, just be watch video after video of different drummers playing and trying to catch all the intricacies in their playing. So yeah, I mean, I can hit some drums, I can maybe hold a basic beat, but I can't play anywhere near the level that would be required to play my own stuff. Arrow plus knee equals adventure over was the first thing I ever heard from you. I gotta say, the laugh when I heard their name of, maybe check it out. Oh. Yeah, Arrow plus knee. So I have, how many hours do I have in Skyrim? I have my Steam open up here. I have 492 hours put into Skyrim. So yeah, it was probably inevitable that I was going to name a song after it. Ever thought about doing a guest solo on Owain's next album? Well, if Owain asked me, I definitely would do. I really dig his stuff, and it'd be really cool. If that were to happen. You'll be in for a hell of a ride if you test out one of the Zara CDs. Ordered my 07 ago a month ago, and the crew's really nice. It's worth to make a trip to Holland for them. So yeah, I mean, I did try the 070, and it's an incredible instrument. I think I love what Pascal's doing. Like, you know, it's rare to see like a lot of innovation, innovation in an instrument. So I think what they're doing is really cool in that regard. It's pretty awesome to see something really sort of new and exciting coming out in the guitar world, especially, you know, when you have the big guns like Fender and Gibson iterating all the time. It's cool to see a guitar company come out and bring out something really different. Okay. When will we see Senpai EP Part 2? So Senpai EP Part 2 will be out after I do this new album. So I already have this sort of high level concept for this sort of story in inverted commas in mind. So for the similarly like I did for Senpai, the first Senpai EP, we will see Prog Chan and her friends continue in their antics of, you know, trying to play guitar and so on. Are you a fan of multi-scale? I sort of think I think it's cool. I do like Strandberg's, like the way that they set up. But I mean, Strandberg's just kind of make you think a little bit differently about how you approach the guitar. I wouldn't say it's necessary for 6 or even 7 string. I just find that having 27 inches of scale length across the board sort of I find it a bit difficult to deal with, especially for playing leads and stuff. So I think for me, it makes the most sense to get an 8 string with a sort of multi-scale neck, so you don't have to sort of compromise on that. What should one do when playing like you and developing a similar shreddy sound? Interesting question. I mean, it's really cheesy, but I just say, you know, the thing that you should do is like, you know, not try and sound like anybody in particular, but you know, they I think it says that, you know, copycat sort of steals from one person, whereas an artist steals from everybody, and I very much agree with that. You steal influences and ideas from as many different artists as possible and join them together into what you think would be your sound. So for me, like, you know, back when I was in high school, you know, the guitar players that influenced me were guys like Steve Vai, John Petrucci, Paul Gilbert, and so on. Joe Satriani as well. So those are the guys that I was sort of trying to steal different licks from and sort of put into my playing. And then the mess that is what I do on a guitar is the result of all that. So I'd say, like, you know, don't try and sound like anybody in particular except yourself. I mean, try and figure out what is your sound. You know, what can you do that's interesting? What can you do that will make people go, oh, I've not heard that before, or I like the way that sounds? I think that'd be my advice there. Should check out the band called Umi, acoustic prog band. Will do. Any plans for UK shows? Yeah, a couple of plans. Nothing I can talk about at the moment, but hopefully we'll be doing some UK shows this year. Yep, is that guitar? Yeah, it's a mayonnaise devel. How do you balance your day job with music and your hobbies? Well, the way I'm going to balance it is by quitting. I'm leaving my job. Okay, hopefully that's the stream working again. Sorry about that. My PC blue screened on me, which is great. Just when you needed it to work. I was answering a good question. Let's see the. Oh God, where was it? How do you balance your day job with your hobbies? So yeah, I'm basically quitting. So that's how I'm balancing it. I think I mentioned before that my job was making me travel for, you know, 4 days out of the week. I'd be living out of a hotel room for different projects, and that just really sucked. I mean, I couldn't work on the album. I couldn't do anything while I was away. I'm balancing by quitting. I mean, if it was a job that didn't make me travel, I probably would have stuck out with it a bit more. But you know, just want to take the plunge. I mean, instead of getting another job, I'm just gonna think, you know, I'm gonna try and make a go of it full time with music. Anybody know what types of pickups I'm using? So in this pick guitar, I've got Seymour Duncan, Nazgul, and Sentience, which is the ones that came with it. In my Mayo 7 string, I have Damasio, Crunch Lab, and Liquifiers. And these pickups are really hot, and I thought, you know, they wouldn't really suit me, but, you know, I've actually quite liked them. These sound really cool for leads as well. Really sort of expressive, really cool sounding. Do you have a bass?
Yes, I do. I have a Yamaha
TRBX 305. I got it for £380. I can't remember, but like absolutely solid bass for what it is. I would not tell, you could not say that this is like a sub £400 bass. It's got an amazing sound. It's featured on all my albums since Pulse. Before that, I was using my brother's bass. How did you meet Pliny? Pliny and I think we first started speaking on these 7-string forums, and then we added each other on Facebook and just was, you know, just talking shit about music and stuff like that. And he was the guitarist of Halcyon back then. And then, he was speaking to me about how he wanted to go solo, and oh my God, did he go solo. His stuff's amazing. I met him sort of online that way. And then decided after I did Invent the Universe that we're going to do the split EP. So we did the split EP together. Then after that, we met in person, so we never actually spoke to each other in person. Never even used Skype, actually, when we did the split EP. So when Pliny was doing like a European travel thing that Australians like to do during their sort of summer break, he came over to Europe, and Paris was like the closest place that he got to the UK. So we had a romantic rendezvous in Paris, and went out for beers, saw some art, saw this amazing gypsy jazz band in a random pub in Paris. And so yeah, that was a cool little trip. This is the part where the stream died in the chat. I Lamau in before PC race, master race. What's your opinion on different tunings? I assume you played in different current ones, but how do you go about picking one? I just pick stand, like, I think it depends on what I want to do. If I want to play these kind of chords, I love these kind of minor 9 chords. So I love those like minor major 9 chords. So like they're really easy to play when you're playing in a drop tuning. But yeah, just standard usually. So it's just standard or a variation on it. So like I said, this is drop D. My 7 strings are in A flat standard. So it's just half a step down, and then drop tune to the low string. And the reason I picked that was, honestly, when I started out playing, it was just like, I thought it was cool just to use something different from just drop A, and periphery were using it. So yeah. Right, more stream issue in the chat here. Right. You should set up a Patreon, would help support your passion. I was gonna say, I think with Patreon, it has to be, sort of, you have to be putting out regular content. And for me, you know, I don't really do regular content. It's usually a lot of content in different patches. So I don't know if I'd maybe run a file of the Patreon terms of service. I mean, like, I might have an option for donations on that. So I'm sort of currently trying to get a website up and running, so I might have an option for donations there. So yeah, we'll see. I mean, like, having different avenues for people to support me would be, you know, cool. But I just don't know if Patreon's the exact one. Favorite alcoholic beverage. I love beer and I love Scotch whiskey. Big whiskey fan. Whiskey is one of those things where, you know, it's not the kind of thing I'd drink on like a night out, or if I was in a pub drinking whiskey, you know, you'd use it just as a sipping drink. I think it's, unless it's like a cheap bottle of whiskey, it's something that I'd savor over a while. So I've got a couple of bottles of whiskey back there, and I've had them for a while actually. So it's just one of those things where every now and then I'll just, you know, have a wee nip or a wee drab of it there. What was my first guitar? My first guitar was an £80 Encore acoustic guitar, which my parents got me from Argos, and I still have it. Look at this piece of shit, it's amazing. So I've been using this on the new album. So the secret to making not really shit guitar, just not shit, is apparently a lot of EQ and compression. So yeah, we'll be hearing this on the new album. How does it feel to have created music that's inspired and brought joy to so many people? It's so weird to me to think that, you know, what I've done is pretty much like a passion hobby project. Is you know, people listen to this and it's like had a real impact on people. It's really humbling, and it's one of those things where, you know, I think it's called the death of the artist. You know, I have my own perceptions and views of, you know, what my music represents and, you know, what is meant to be, what is meant to say, and everybody else will take their own interpretation of that and will say, you know, this is what I, you know, think, this is what I hear when I listen to this music, or this is what I hear when I listen to this song. And I guess that if it takes that out of your hands, you know, there's no one set interpretation of the music. People can sort of, you know, feel or, you know, get whatever output they want from listening to it. So I think that's quite cool. But yeah, it's incredibly humbling to think that, you know, it influences people. And when I get messages saying, you know, they hadn't been playing guitar, but they listened to some one of my songs and it made them pick them up. Or I got a message about someone saying that, you know, he was teaching his son double helix. I was just like, wow, this is incredible. Because, you know, it's just really cool to think that, you know, my music has reached people in, you know, the far corners of the earth. It's a pretty sort of humbling feeling. Makes you feel very small, I think, given, you know, I'm sort of unimportant, I guess, in that fact. The music has become the most important thing, you know. So it's really cool. Hopefully I'll make a London gig. Will there be a tour with David Maximicic, Pliny, and you? Oh my god, I wish that would happen. Yeah. David has messaged us, you know, saying that we should try and get something organized, but it's just never gotten around to that. So hopefully it'll happen. I think playing the whole of the Split EP at TechFest last year, at the TechFest after party, was one of the highlights of my year. You know, playing with Pliny, the fact that, you know, a few hours before I'm into play, we were sat out in a grass field with a laptop with Guitar Pro and a couple of beers and just desperately trying to make sure that we knew the parts was really quite good fun. How do you overcome writer's block? So I generally just stop. So it depends. Like, sometimes, you know, I feel like I can power through and I feel I've got the energy and commitment to really just power through with the song. Sometimes I'll just take a break, you know, stop. At the moment, you know, with my current album, if I feel like I'm not getting anywhere, I'll stop off and I'll play XCOM for a few hours or something. Sorry, I'm just replying to a message to one of the Wired Guitars guys. So yeah, in terms of, yeah, writer's block, I'll just, you know, persist or take a break. And I think that's pretty much the only thing you can do. Sometimes, you know, with certain songs, you know, I'll go away for a couple of days as well, and then come back to it with a sort of fresh viewpoint. But I'm one of these people that I kind of get influenced by everything I see and hear. So, you know, music that, you know, Game of Thrones music or something like that, or anime music very sort of clearly, or music in a film or a TV show, or just, you know, something I heard in the street, something I heard a busker play. I find I'm very influenced by that. So, yeah, sometimes just taking a break and, you know, taking in some more sounds can sort of freshen up your mind and give you new ideas. At what age did you start playing? So I started playing guitar when I was about 12. So the reason I started playing was in a music class in high school, they had some acoustic guitars and, you know, they taught us some chords. You know, your D, E minor. I think it was that Wet 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 song. I think it was literally these chords that they taught us. I think it was. I think that's I Feel It In My Fingers. I can't remember the actual song, the song name. But yeah, learned those chords and I was absolutely hooked on, you know, playing cheesy chords and bugged my parents to give me a guitar. They gave me that cheap Encore acoustic one. And the other guitar I got offered it was a Yamaha electric guitar. So that was my first electric, and I had a little terrible amp, and I would just learn like Red Hot Chili Peppers songs and stuff like that. So that was when I started. So back when I was 12, but it was only, I think it was 16, 17 when I sort of really started seriously thinking about, you know, I want to play, you know, lead guitar. You know, I want to be able to shred like John Petrucci. I still can't, but it's a sort of ongoing aim. And then what age do you want to pursue music career? Probably about the same time. You know, I saw guys like, you know, I saw the Steve Vais and the Joe Satrianis and the Paul Gilberts, you know, doing, playing guitar as a job. And I was just like, I want to be able to do that. So it's been a long, long time since then. But, you know, hopefully the next couple of months will enable that. And hopefully I'll be able to do it full time. Favorite anime opening? Probably Cowboy Bebop. Tank. What does it go? Yeah, probably Tank, the Cowboy Bebop opening. Have you ever been injured while playing guitar? What's your warm-up routine? Luckily, I've never been injured. Generally, to warm up, I'll just sort of noodle. I'll just, you know, play something like, you know. I'll just get my fingers moving, and then once I feel fairly comfortable, I'll start playing properly. Mechanical keyboard? Yes, I do have a mechanical keyboard. I have this Steel Series. Can you even see that? Steel Series GC6. Oh god, I can't remember the name. Steel Series mechanical keyboard. What are you gassing for the most? What gear do you want for your purposes? Kind of not gassing for anything at the moment. I've got a Mayo Regis 6-string on order. Not been struck by gas. I think the last time I struck by gas was I played this it was a hardtail Shure. I've never actually seen a Shure with a hardtail. It was a hardtail Shure, and the thing played absolutely beautifully. And it was £2,300, which was money I did not have at the time because I just bought this and I've just bought flights to Japan. So that was the last thing I really gassed hard for. I do like Shures. They're really nice guitars. We played Tank and Jazz Band this semester. Good shit. Oh yeah, awesome. Must be really fun to play that in the jazz track. So how do you achieve your tone for recording rhythm? So in terms of like rhythm tones, one of the easiest things you can do that will really add a lot of tightness to your sound is just run a tube screamer or a overdrive type pedal in front. What I do is I've got the tube screamer in the XFX sort of chain, and I've got the distortion set to zero, and I've got the tone set to full. So let's see if I can show this. So yeah, so this is what my rhythm tone sounds like right now. So if I turn off the drive pedal, and then if I turn it back on, it immediately adds a lot more sort of clarity and attack to it, especially when you're playing when you're playing the djenti stuff. The drive pedal really helps. Having a bit of compression as well on the chain really helps too. Drive pedal in front is a really quick and easy way to try and sort of tighten up your tone. Whether that's with an XFX or with a real drive pedal, you can do that. In the tight budget, what do you recommend first? Audio interface or monitor speakers? That's a tough question. I'd probably go for the audio interface first, to be honest, because really, having a clean input is really important. And I actually didn't have monitors for ages. I think I did at the Cassini, I did ILZP, and I did Invent the Universe all without studio monitors. I only managed to get studio monitors after that. I go for the audio interface first because getting a clean input is really important. 6505 plus question mark. Not sure what that's asking. Next question. Found music 5 years ago on Destiny's stream. Usually had some good prog metal going at the time. Ever going to stream on Twitch again? I streamed on Twitch last week, actually. I played some XCOM just because I was a little bit bored of recording, so I wanted to take a break, and I thought, you know, I'd stream. I'm probably going to try and do, you know, every couple of weeks, stream some games. I'm thinking of streaming some Darkest Dungeon because I find games like, you know, XCOM Darkest Dungeon where shit can go wrong to be really fun to play. Because I'm a awful, awful, awful person for save scumming on games like XCOM. So playing on stream means that I can't. It forces me to actually play the game. So yeah, I think I'll probably be streaming something like Darkest Dungeon or something. Best practice amp. To be honest, like, again, amps, I have very little knowledge about amps. I've not owned an amp for the past 6 years at least. So I've just been practicing using Lepo Legion mostly, and then I've got practicing using the Axe FX now, so I'm probably not the person to ask for practice amps. How do you feel about your Nazgul's Zentians? Didn't really warm to me at first, but I quite like them now. Again, it's one of those things where the pickups are really high output. They really work well for leads, so. Yeah, I quite like them. Lots of, you know, bite, a lot of attacks. I think that'd be pretty fun. It's weird though. Like I said, I think I said it before. I'm not the person to ask when it comes to pickups. I don't have that much experience. I've just been using stock pickups for the longest time. I think it's probably something you should ask someone else. Speaking of gaming, do you find a correlation between video games and playing or writing guitar, whether with technique or composing? Not really. I think video games are very much sort of, my brain goes into lazy mode. But like what I do find is I'll hear something cool. I'll hear something cool about, something musically cool, and then that will sort of make me think I want to do that on guitar. And I think I said before, like, I tend to get influenced by everything. So video games are one of those things where, you know, I'll hear something and think, you know, this is cool. I want to be able to reproduce this in a song. So like, even in a game like, FTL's got really cool sort of synthy, sort of space-ish music. And like, that's influenced something on the new album as well. So the new album definitely has like a video game music influence in there. Do you have any suggestions for learning theory of guitar and applying it to create music and write licks? For example, when you get a backing, how do you start jamming or writing a solo?
It's weird because I've gotten to the point where, like, you know, I'll hear a backing track and I'll figure out what key it's in, and then I'll just play over it because, you know, I know the scales and stuff like that. So the thing to do is just, like, I think my brain likes to work very methodically. I like to be very sort of rigorous about things. So what I'll do is, let's say if you have a backing track that, you know, is like an A minor. So you know you want to be playing you want to be playing an A minor over that, and then what I do is, you know, obviously, well, maybe not obviously to everybody, but like, you know, it's you got your C major scale, and A minor is one of the modes of there. So like, knowing that relationship is really useful. And then what I do is, you know, for each chord, each one of those notes in that scale has a different relationship to those chords. So like, for instance, in A minor, an A has that a certain relationship. But if you change the chord to F major 7, that A has a different relationship to the F. And the A has a different relationship to the G. And a different relationship to the D. And a different relationship to the C. So understanding those relationships to the chords really helps. And being able to... And it really helps. It means you can sort of be very specific about your note choice as well. And you can say, you know, over this chord, I want to play this note, and that will have this impact as opposed to this impact. I think that helps. So I think you just have to sort of bite the bullet and learn the scales, and learn, you know, what the notes in the scale are, and learn the different key signatures, what scale or key you have to be in over which chords. Then after that, you can try and get creative and, you know, be really focused on things like note choice and so on. Greetings from Mexico City. Hello to you as well. Okay. So if I'll do what I was doing before and I'll just noodle, and if anybody has any more questions, I'll just keep noodling. Look into learning intervals and scale degrees, you'll understand relationships C2's talk about. Yeah, definitely. Like, so if I want to be a bit more sort of rigorous in my definition, so when you play an A over the chord A, that's the root note, that's note one. But if in an F, that A becomes note three. So learning that relationship is really quite useful. Because, you know, like each note will have a different relationship to each chord. And that's sort of really important to know. Well, it's, again, some people play without theory. What was I saying? Like, some people can, you know, play really cool stuff without knowing that much theory. I find, you know, for my own brain, it's good to know theory. And like learning the theory has helped it become sort of second nature to me. Good suggestions for backing tracks. To be honest, what I used to do when I was learning is I'd fire up Guitar Pro, and I'd just write some chords of Guitar Pro and loop that and then play over that. So I actually tried to make my own backing tracks, which is probably why it might be the reason why my lead style is so specific. Like I find that my lead style's the way it is just because I've tried to learn over my own stuff. Resources to learn this stuff. I just had countless Google searches, countless YouTube videos of different things I watched. It's like, as with most things in life, there probably isn't like one fit all solution. You probably have to, you know, consume a lot of different sources for that kind of thing, and sort of build that, use that, those different sources to build your knowledge. I think if there's one book where, you know, that was the go-to place for learning theory, I think everybody would own it. But, you know, that sort of thing doesn't really exist. Cool. Favorite Pokemon movie? God, I think I've only watched the first two, and that was ages ago. Systematically, not just a random YouTube tutorial. Like I said before, just taking as many different sources and just trying to build together your knowledge and just compiling from all those different sources. Because like I said, there's no magic bullet. There's no sort of one size all fits solution. It's just a case of trying to learn as many things as possible from as many different sources. And what I found is, like, sometimes you find contradictions in different sources. Some sources will tell you one thing, and those are good to understand as well, because you understand the approach from which those people are talking about theory and talking about the application of theory. Added me in Steam. Cool. What made me realize that I tend to use the same notes in every single solo? I was just listening back to some stuff and just thinking, you know, it's kind of like the lick. I was watching it was the G3 performance of when John Petrucci first played with G3, and he was playing a solo in Glasgow Kiss, and he, I think he played this phrase. And what I did was just reverse those. And it just sort of just kept on occurring. And before I knew it, it was in a lot of my solos. Do you miss playing in a band? I mean, I did until I started playing. I started playing with the guys for Tech Fest when we were practicing, and that was absolutely incredible. Like, just having that sort of organic sort of relationship with other band members and watching Jamie, the drummer, sort of reinterpret the way that I programmed the drums was really cool. So I do get to experience it still, which is cool. What jobs did Jay and then nothing there? So if you could maybe finish that question. Favorite guilty pleasure band or song? Guilty pleasure band or song. I don't think I really have a guilty pleasure band, but I definitely am a huge obviously anime nerd, so I do quite enjoy listening to to anime openings and so on. Did you write Particles Collide with Pliny, or did you just get him to riff on your song? No, I wrote the song. Basically, in terms of the guest solos, what generally happens is that I'll write a song, and then there'll be a section where, you know, I kind of, mostly I can't be bothered writing a solo, so I'll reach out to somebody that I think will do a cool solo for me. And for that, yeah, there's that little section. I thought it'd be cool for Pliny to do a solo. So that was a really cool solo. But yeah, we'll just have a part and ask them to play over it. What kind of picks are you using? I'm using Jazz 3 XLs. I can't really play with Jazz 3s, they're way too small, but I do like having that sharp point, so Jazz 3 XLs are what I go for. I used to use Tortex 3s, but they wear down way too fast, so yeah, I using the Jazz 3 XLs. How many different jobs have you had? So this corporate job was my first job. My friends in high school used to call me a work-shy fob because I never had any part-time jobs during high school or uni. Yeah, this corporate job was my first, and it's unfortunately burned me out from the world of doing corporate consulting very quickly. I don't think I'm the right personality type for it. Cool. So feel free to keep asking questions. Until then, I'll just noodle. And like, noodling for me is just like a way of maybe coming up with different melodies or licks or so on. So I'll just, you know, be sitting. If I pick a key, let's say F sharp minor. I love F sharp minor, I don't know why, but it's nice to see that you remember your songs. I watch other musicians that just try to play something and stop until I actually don't remember quite well. No, I'm one of those musicians. I remember parts of some of my songs, but trying to ask me to play an entire song is not going to go well because I probably won't remember it. And again, that's just a consequence of how I write as well, because it's a very transient writing method. I'll write a riff and then I'll go into the next one and never actually learn it properly. Like, I'll be able to play the riff well enough to record it, but then it doesn't really stick in my head. So like, learning stuff to play live is quite a challenge because I have to go back and actually, you know, figure out, you know, how to try and remember it and trying to remember that and actually trying to figure it live, because there's some parts of my songs where it made sense when I was recording it, but like, from a live, trying to play the notes on a fretboard perspective in one sitting, it was quite challenging. So yeah, there's a little bit of that. So no, I'm ask me to play a certain song like at random and it's most likely that I won't be able to play it. Do you take any influence from the playing of Guthrie Govan? I think that's pretty obvious from the whole yeah, I'm a big Guthrie fan. And I, you know, I'm amazed by how he manages to use only three fingers and completely neglect his pinky, but yeah, a huge Guthrie Govan fan. I think I tried to learn I can't remember. I tried to learn fives at one point and I just gave up because not as good as Guthrie. Favorite cheesy sounds, pinches, squeals, dive bombs. Yeah, I do pinch harmonics all the time, so like, I love cheesy pentatonic melodies as well, or just cheesy melodies in general, as you can probably tell from like in terms of placement, it's just like, I know, you just kind of get used to knowing when a good time to throw something in is, and doing too much of one thing, it can get very old very quickly. So if you do something like, you know, pinch harmonics all the time. I mean, that loses interest very quickly. So if you do other things like dive bombs or like flutters with a trem handle or stuff like that, very often, you know, it basically sort of thing, you know, when does this become too much, and then maybe dial it back from there. What do you think about fancy handmade custom guitars like Black Machines or Vic? Will they help to make your tone a lot better, or is it truly about you to play? So I kind of think that after playing my Mayonnaise, I definitely think it's a case of, you know, niceness to play. You definitely reach a point of diminishing returns when you reach that high end, though. So like, if there's like, you know, my Mayonnaise compared to, let's say, an $8,000 Shure, are you getting, you know, an extra, like, you know, are you getting an extra $5,000 worth of tone out of that? I don't think so. So I think it's at that level, it becomes, you know, more about niceness to play, and then features as well. So different things like different exotic woods and different things we'll probably throw in. Again, I'm probably not the world's biggest expert. I like playing guitars. Doesn't mean I know everything about them. But yeah, I definitely think, you know, niceness to play is probably the main thing that you get from sort of high-end, really expensive guitars. Do you have a SoundCloud I can check out? Yes, I do have a SoundCloud, although I don't really post that much there. It's mostly just little tone tests. And I did a cover of a sort of electronic dance music anime-influenced electronic dance music song there. So I'll link my SoundCloud in the chat there. Guilty pleasure and Guitar Zach 45. Thanks for checking out the stream. See that you have a lot of friends on Facebook. Do you have another private account, or how do you manage all the constant messages? I don't have another Facebook account. The one that I use is my personal account that I've had since uni. I don't get too many messages. I usually only get a few messages a day. So it's not too bad to deal with. It's not to the point where, you know, I'm getting like dozens and dozens of messages an hour, and I just, you know, if it was like that, I maybe would make another account. But at the moment, it's all manageable. I do everything. I try to answer all messages by myself. Unfortunately, I'm not the best at that. I manage it all at the moment. Guilty pleasures in terms of music, I think it's pretty obvious. It's anime music. Ever made an attempt to learn Kafur from Animals as Leaders? I think I tried to learn the first sweet pick part and then just gave up because I'm a lazy twat who can't be bothered to learn anything anymore. Any techniques that you actively shy away with from your writing because you find it difficult? Do you find that writing plays your technical strengths? Definitely. Like, my writing style is completely built around the way I play guitar. The one thing that I don't do a lot of is sweep picking. The sweep patterns I do play are stuff like, I used to play that pattern. I used to play, you probably hear that my sweep picking is nowhere near as good as it should be. I tend not to do a lot of sweep picking. I don't economy pick either. I can't economy pick, so that's something I else do. But like, for me, it's kind of like, there's, you know, I think it's definitely a case of playing to your strengths. I saw a Tom Quayle clinic, and he, you know, he says that, you know, there's some things that he can't do. So Tom Quayle has the most amazing legato. But, you know, he pretty straight up admitted, you know, there's certain things that he doesn't do well, and he won't do it because of that. And to me, if someone like Tom Quayle says, you know, there are things I can't play, and, you know, you play to your strengths, then for me, it's like, yeah, I think that works for me too. Expanding on my style, I think I'll just try and get better at what I do. Like,
I'm doing a lot of, you know, practicing for my alternate picking and stuff like that. Because like trying to watch Jason Richardson, for instance, like the alternate picking is mind blowing. So if I can get halfway as decent as good as he is, alternate picking, I'll be happy. So just again, just expanding on what I'm doing. What did you do to be able to comprehend the joy of programming drums? Just spending a lot of time with it. I think I mentioned it before in the stream, but I spent a lot of time watching drummers play. So, you know, watching how jazz drummers play, watching how guys like, you know, Matt Halpern, how they approach the drums, and looking for the little intricacies that they do in videos and things. So I tried to incorporate that into my programming, and then Control C, Control V, a lot of that. So what I do is I'll copy paste huge swaths of drums, and I'll go back in and I'll manually edit velocities, add in fills and stuff like that. So that's generally what I do when programming. Budget 7-string guitars. I honestly wouldn't, again, like, I don't like giving recommendations unless I have experience with something. So I've not played many budget 7-strings recently. So I don't think I can give a recommendation on that. Although, you know, I've got an Ibanez, which a Prestige, like RG-1527, when Prestige was still sort of not insanely expensive. So I think, you know, you can't really go wrong with an Ibanez, or Ibanez, I think that's how you pronounce it. Yeah, Ibanez 7-string. Very solid for what they are. How many layers do you put in your guitar tracks? As many as I need. So again, there's no set thing. So for instance, if all I need in the guitar track is just like, you know, one of these, that's what I'll add. If it needs like, you know, several different layers or different things, then that's what I'll add. So again, it just depends on the song. Again, with these things, there's no set thing. There's no tried and true method or number, because it just depends on the song. And part of what I feel is part of good songwriting is, you know, being able to appreciate when enough is enough or when enough isn't enough, kind of thing. Thoughts on the Ibanez RGIF-7 and the Per Nielsen Strandy sig? I don't know what the RGIF-7 is. I don't really follow all the new guitars that Ibanez has been releasing. Pernus and Sandy Strig, it looks cool. I mean, I personally wouldn't get it. In terms of Strandberg in general, I find like the Injernet kind of, it really disagrees with me, because the way that I place my thumb, and like I have a lot of sort of thumb there, and I just sort of, it doesn't sit well with me. So like the Strandberg neck's kind of doesn't work too well for me. Sweep picking is the only thing that I can't do. But again, like, you know, like I said, if it's not essential to your music, then, you know, do you really need it? It's like a sort of what's the cost of learning to sweep pick a lot of time? What's the cost of not having it? Does it make your song worse, for instance? And you know, for me, it means that I'm mostly really selective. But it's more effective when I've been selective. So I mean, like, it means I'm more selective when I use it, and like when it does occur in my songs, I feel that that's when it adds, you know, that extra bit of interest in a song. What do you think, guys? Those super fancy guitar players, Sergey Golovin, he uses a whole bunch of fancy techniques up, chicken pick, thimble pitch, etc. Well, if someone like, you know, Sergey can do that, then that's awesome. I think, you know, the whole point of guitar techniques is like, some people really overemphasize, you know, knowing guitar techniques as a sort of means to an end. Whereas for me, guitar techniques are just a means or a tool with which you try and express yourself musically. So again, for me, the techniques that I know on guitar, you know, for me, I feel that that's what I need to express myself musically. Otherwise, you know, it's good to know them. It's good to know the basic ones as well. But power to people that can do all that kind of stuff. I just certainly can't. What do you do when you have a family reunion, aunts especially, and they ask you to play something? And do you find that embarrassing playing for a normal public? Luckily, I haven't actually had my aunts all live in a different country, so
My extended family all that still live in Burma, so I don't really, never really come across that. RG IF7 is the fan fret guitar. Any opinions on the current Iron Label series? Yeah, I think they look cool. I mean, again, I'll have to play one before I make any judgment. I'm very much like, very much that I have to, you know, experience and sit down with an instrument before I can make a sort of full judgment about it. Favorite source of sheep. This is Metab. Well, being in Scotland, we have plenty of sheep. So Scotland's my favorite source of sheep. Can this be uploaded on the YouTube channel after the stream? So I'm not sure if this is actually recording, or whether they whether this is actually sort of being saved. So I'm not sure what the deal is. If there's going to be if there's going to be anything afterwards, so I wouldn't know. Yeah, it's pretty cool that people are calling me Senpai, but with my last name. I'm thinking of wrapping up soon, so if you have any other questions, like, throw them in. Otherwise, I'm just going to noodle. Do you prefer 25.5 or 26.5 shell for 7-string guitars? 25.5. I'm much more comfortable playing leads on a 25.5-inch neck. It's just... Even just making it an inch longer, the extra tension you got on the same gauge of strings makes it... I find myself feeling a lot more hesitant about doing big bends, like... I find myself a lot less comfortable doing those type of bends on a longer scale length, so I much prefer having a... the 25.5-inch scale neck. Do you prefer 6 or 7-string guitars? I've got no preference. I'll happily switch between them, and it just depends on what the song needs. So if the song needs that low chug, that 7-string stuff, then that's what I'll use. Otherwise, if the song doesn't need that low tuning, then I'll use 6-string. I'm very happy to switch between the two. Favorite clothing article would be anime t-shirts. Favorite anime, probably Steins Gate. Is a favorite. Cowboy Bebop's another favorite. Puella Majimadoka Magica. Can't remember the full name. That's really good as well. How important is low high preferred action for you? I much prefer having a low string height. So relatively sort of flat neck, not too much bow to it, low string height. I don't mind the fret buzz because, you know, I think it adds that aggression to the tone. So yeah, it's so cool. Don't know why I play that, but yeah. 25.5, I think, is the standard. Well, it depends. Like, most Strat and Super Strat guitars will be 25.5. Gibsons and PRSs are 25. So they have even sort of lighter. Gold Solaris of 2016. Release this album, release Senpai EP2, have a successful tour in Japan, get more shows set up. If I can, I want to get a UK tour set up with the intention of doing a European and a US tour next year. Any suggestions for learning how to write drum tracks? Everything I know how to do now is just a result of me just, you know, going in and just trying it, failing early and learning, you know, learning from those mistakes. So yeah, I think, you know, just try it, and, you know, if you get stuck, look on the internet. Like, the internet's such an amazing resource for learning different things. Like, so like I said, there's nothing specific I can point you in the way of, but, you know, it's just one of the things you got to try it. The YOLO approach to music production is what I call it. So, you've got to just go in for it. Any tips for studying effectively for long hours at a time? Well, my first bit of advice would be to stop it as soon as it stops getting interesting or boring or difficult, because I think it's especially true of guitar. Like, you know, if you've got a long practice session on the guitar and your hands start hurting or you just stop feeling interested about something, you know, it's good to take a break and keep things fresh. Because if it's like, if playing guitar becomes like a boring chore, then, you know, it just makes it that more difficult to do. How's the Scottish prog scene? In terms of gigs, it's really good. Glasgow's amazing for gigs. You know, I've seen so many bands, and, you know, I just recently saw Tesseract and The Contortionists. Last year I saw Periphery, Between the Bird and Me, Carnival, Monuments, Sky Harbor. Just, it's great for gigs. Glasgow's a great city for that as well. Gibson's 24.75. I can honestly tell you. I think it's 25, but I'm not sure exactly. Someone confirmed that. Canadian tour, please. Yes. When can we expect the new album? Before the Japan tour, at the very sort of latest, I think. Any juicy info on the new album, title or anything? No title yet, because there isn't one. But like I think I mentioned this before, the album's going to be a double album. It's going to be about 70 minutes long. So the first disc is going to be about 45 minutes. The second disc is going to be about 25, 30 minutes. So it's going to be a long album. Lots of long songs as well. And the first half of the album, the first disc, is a set of sort of really diverse songs where the transitions in the songs are going to be like really sharp, really sudden, really harsh. So that's the idea between the first half. And the second half is going to be like more of a, it's going to be all connected. There's going to be a running sort of a theme for that, for the song. It's all going to run together as one sort of continuous thing. So yeah, that's some info on the new album. Do you see the djent movement within progressive metal as a fad? You know, this is opening a can of worms. I mean, I still do it. I still love just, you know, doing, you know, I still find that incredibly fun. But it's, again, it's with anything. Like, trying to base an entire sort of song around this, I mean, like, you can lose interest very quickly. And that's why Periphery's been successful, because they've diversified, they've made, you know, they've expanded upon, you know, this. You know, they've managed to expand upon that into, you know, what their style is today, so. Yeah, I think with anything, you know, you try and build music from just one idea, and, you know, it gets boring very quickly. Whereas if you know, if you make, you know, if you build other ideas in, it's going to be a lot more interesting. What tone would your cabinet? Oh, we got. Do your facial hair and glasses shape your tone? Very much so. Any gas for guitars right now? I'm just waiting on my next Mayonnaise. I ordered a Mayonnaise Regis 6-string, so I'm waiting for that. I heard it's going to be with me in April, so I absolutely cannot wait, because they take ages to finish. So that's like spec'd out custom, so can't wait for it. What chair do you use when you're recording? Do you think it impacts your tone? I use a mesh chair. With a custom cover made by my mum, and I think it amplifies my tone significantly. If someone has been playing the guitar for 4 years and got quite okay at playing, what guitar range would you recommend for him if he currently only owns 200 euro budget guitars? Honestly, you buy whatever guitars you want. I mean, I've seen some people, you know, shit all over people for, you know, so they've only played guitar for a couple of years and they go buy themselves a £2,000 custom guitar. And people say stuff like, you know, why is a player like you using a, like, a custom guitar? I'm just like, let people play what they want to play. If you're, you know, one of the best guitarists in the world and you still just want to play £500 guitars, that's fine. If you're just starting out but you want to get yourself a Mayonnaise custom, or if you want to get an Aristides, then that's fine too. I think there's nothing. No one should tell you what instruments you should be playing. You play the guitars you want to play. So, you know, if it's within your budget range, buy yourself an awesome custom guitar, regardless of how long you've been playing. I mean, I was playing for 4 years and I got myself a, my parents gave me an American Deluxe Fender Strat, which, you know, someone playing 4 years might seem a bit sort of, you know, does he really need that kind of guitar? But, you know, play what you want to play, get what you can get. Have you met all your guitar heroes now that you've been in the music booth for a while? Still not met guys like, you know, John Petrucci and you know, Steve Vai. Like, those would be, you know, and Paul Gerber. Those people would be absolutely amazing to meet. I saw Guthrie Govan Clinic, although we didn't get a chance to meet him afterwards, unfortunately. But yeah, like, it'd be really cool to, you know, meet some people like Tosin Abasi, meet people like, you know, Misha Mansur. Unfortunately, like, when Periphery last played Glasgow, like, I was in contact with Mark from Periphery, but we didn't get a chance to meet up, unfortunately. But it'd be really cool to meet those people. Ever tried a carbon Kiesel? No. Lots of hype going around them, but no. Again, I got to try them before I buy them, I think. How's your Erhu going? I can play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star on it. I'm not going to on stream because I do appreciate that some of you guys still want to retain your hearing, so I won't subject you to that. Any tips for an intermediate level guitarist that wants to get more into playing prog specifically? Just learn prog songs, I think, you know. Intermediate's a bit of a broad term, but, you know, just... What I found when I was sort of, I guess, an intermediate level player is I'd learned songs that were just above what I think I could play. And that really sort of, you know, it's good because, you know, it's tangible. You can see where you want to get to and you can see yourself actually doing it while still challenging you at the same time. So, yeah, I definitely say just learn different prog songs. So back in my day, when I was in high school, it was Dream Theater. So, you know, I'd learn, you know, stuff from Scenes from a Memory. Stuff like that. I mean, like, that's where I sort of would say. What festivals are you planning to attend this year? I'm definitely going to attend Tech Fest. The lineup is insane. Like, definitely have to get myself to Tech Fest. In terms of other festivals, I'm not sure. I've not really been much of a festival guy, to be honest. I just see gigs in the city I live in. But yeah, definitely going to get myself to Tech Fest. What do you think of mellow death bands like Arch Enemy and Children of Bodom? I don't listen to them, so I can't really comment. Not for any particular reason, it's just I've never gotten around to listening to them. Any tips on how to shape your personal style and tone? So, yeah, I think I answered something like this before. So it's just, in terms of shaping your own style, it's just taking... It's impossible to be truly original because, you know, everybody's used these same 12 notes to death and variations of those 12 notes and things in between. So thing to do is just, you know, take all your influences. For me, guys like Paul Gilbert, like learning stuff like, that thing, which I can't play cleanly anymore, apparently. And like, you know, taking those things from guys like Paul Gilbert and then, you know, from Steve Vai, his weird sort of, and then from Guthrie Govan, his, That kind of stuff from Guthrie, and like trying to throw them all together, mash them together, you know, combine those things and try and utilize what you like to sort of shape like what you think is your style. Favorite Meshuggah album? Probably nothing or Catch 33. Hip-hop fan. I do quite like Kendrick stuff. I can't remember if I listened to Untitled or not. I can't remember the name of the album. I listened to the one with the swimming pools on it. I can't remember what the album was called, but yeah, quite like Kendrick. What is the amp modeling and cab usually used for lead and rhythm? So like I said before in the stream, was the Das Metal amp. I'm using the Mesa Boogie cab and another cab. I can't remember. Like I said, I've got to open up Axedit. Do I use Imgur? I use it for browsing anime memes, and then I shitpost those anime memes onto the Music Discussion Facebook page and the and my Twitter. My Twitter is a sort of abandon hope all ye who enter here kind of place. So yeah, the cabs I use are the 4x12 Recto and the 4x12 Solo V12. He just put out an album EP a few days ago, really jazzy shit. It's a Kendrick, yeah, I'll check it out. What game franchise would you like contribute to its OST? I'd love to do something for, if it was sort of no holds barred, I'd love to do something for Mass Effect, just because I've spent so many hours dedicating my life to playing Mass Effect. It'd be really cool to play some music for a Mass Effect. Cool. Where's my other window? C2's Twitter is beautiful. Yeah, my Twitter is a place of very, very weird things. Basically, because I don't really give a shit about what I say on Twitter. So I just kind of, you know, I just use it as a place to shitpost. And it's a sort of outlet for that more weeby side of my personality. Favorite video games, like I said, Mass Effect, Skyrim, I love The Witcher. Witcher 3 is great. I still need to dedicate more time to it. I love FTL. It's a great Wii game. And I'm currently playing a lot of XCOM 2. As buggy as it is, it's a lot of good fun. What brought you to the Wired Guitarist Music Discussion page? How long have you been on it? And what was your first thought of all the craziness in there? So I can't remember who invited me. Someone invited me to the group, and then, you know, I sort of decided to stick around because there's a lot of cool discussion, a lot of cool sort of posts about guitars and stuff. And I found that, you know, people actually knew of me on the group. So whenever I found that I could get away with shit posting freely. So it's like, it's free reign to shit post. So yeah, I'm probably one of the worst people on that group. So don't judge yourself too harshly. I wonder how big you have to get before you have to start giving a shit. Like, I guess. I think for guys in the prog scene, not giving a shit's a good attitude to have, because when you really start giving a shit and thinking of yourself as more important as maybe you are, then I think you maybe lose touch with a bit reality. I try my best to be as self-deprecating as possible, because, you know, it helps. If I'm harsh, if I, you know, joke about myself at my own expense, then, you know, it makes it more comfortable for other people to do so, and, you know, it keeps you down to earth. Good, you know, getting the piss taken out of you is a good way to keep yourself down to earth. Dark Souls, yeah, definitely Dark Souls. I still need to finish Dark Souls 2, and Dark Souls 3 is coming out. And I also still need to finish Bloodborne, but I struggle to play Bloodborne because it's on my PS4 and it's locked to 30 frames a second. And being the massive PC master racer that I am, I really struggle with 30 frames a second. Did you play... First anime you watched was... Oh my god, I think it was Neon Genesis Evangelion. So yeah, I had a really, really tough introduction to anime because I think it was Evangelion, the first thing I watched. Do you play D2 LOD? I don't know what that is. Unexpected genres or artists that you're a big fan of? I can't really say. I think quite a big fan of Tricot, who are Japanese... sort of poppy math rock band, so didn't expect that I'd be as big a fan of that as I would be, but then I really am. And yeah, just anime music in general. Didn't expect a big metal guy like me to really like it, but yeah, I do. Nobody is worse than Matthew. I think about banning him daily. I think this is Metab bringing up taking out his frustrations of being banned daily on the Seven String forums by banning people daily on music discussion, because I do remember how many times that Stealth-tastic or Stealth-gent-tastic got banned. Those were interesting times. Those were more innocent times. Diablo 2, Lord of Discretion. I never really played Diablo. Favorite hammer-on tapping exercises. So like one thing I quite like is there's in Scarified by Paul Gilbert, he plays this thing at the end, which is I'm not gonna attempt to play it fast. It's like, and he plays that. And what I found is that you can add this note and this note, and you get. And then you can add like a little, you can add a tap on two frets above the highest note there. So you get. Which I think has a really cool sound. I'm gonna cheat actually and get my governor thing. Wrapping a sock around your guitar or using Grovy is a great way of hiding from the internet how terrible a guitar player you actually are. So I think that's a really cool, like, tapping legato lick. What's your greatest of all time album? Probably like in terms of like old school stuff, like I guess, you know, Scenes from Memory, Dream Theater, like stuff like that, was one of the best sort of prog albums I heard, and like Dream Theater never really reached those heights, so that's probably one of those. There's probably some other things that I just can't remember. I'm really bad at answering sort of favorite questions. What's my favorite things questions? Do you plan to use the Vocaloid such as Miku in your music in the future? I actually used the Miku pedal in Oh Shit, I'm Late for School in the Senpai EP. What I did was I sampled the notes, because it doesn't track very well, there's a delay. So what I did was I sampled the notes and I used that as a sort of synth in the intro. So in the whole song, the Miku pedal is actually going when it's along with the synth. Do you ever hear those initial Megadeth mixes on YouTube? I haven't, no. That's a really big TV. Yeah, so my dad wanted to get a 4K TV, so he didn't have any room for his old TV, so he gave it to me. So, I wasn't actually planning on getting a TV, but my dad gave me one. So my dad gave me the old family TV that we had for about, I think it was about 5 years. How tall are you? 5'11½. So... I like to say I'm 6 foot with the hair, but I think I'm technically 5'11½. Will you record stuff with a Miku pedal for the album? No, I don't think so. I think this is meant to be a serious album in inverted commas, so I definitely won't be using the Miku pedal. Preferred render file extension. So if I'm rendering projects, always WAV. I think I export my projects at 24-bit 44.1 kilohertz WAV files, and then I have to put them down to 16-bit for uploading onto TuneCore for sort of Spotify and iTunes stuff. Favorite pickups, favorite brand. Pickup brand. I don't know. I've got different pickups on my guitar. So in my Mayo, I've got in my Mayo 7 string, I've got Crunch Lab and Liquifier DiMarzios, and I've got Seymour Duncan Nazgul and Sentience and this. So I don't know. I think I'm yet to find my favorite. Favorite periphery jam. I love Scarlet. It's really cool. AxeFX supports 48 kilohertz though. To be honest, like
that addition of extra sample rate, for me, like, the only reason you'd go to a much higher sample rate is if you're, you know, planning on doing a lot of time stretching, so you get the extra sort of resolution there. But you know, I don't do time stretching, so recording at 44.1 kilohertz is fine. And you know, I'm like, when I push the music out to Bandcamp and stuff, it's gonna be at 44.1 kilohertz anyway, so I don't really see the need to go that extra. What other instruments do you play? Just bass. I think I answered this before. I'd love to be able to play piano and drums, but I can't really. I can hit the drum kit, I can play a beat on the drums, but that's about it. From your guitarist, which is your favorite? That's a really harsh question. Because they're all my favorites. Sentimental value wise, is probably my Stratocaster. That guitar is 10 years old now. In terms of favorites to play, it's probably my Mayos. I love the way that the Regis and the Duval play. Is money from Spotify a real thing? Yes, you can actually make money from Spotify. It is real. I just got here and you're saying you're not going to use the Miku. I'm not going to use the Miku on the current album. I'm definitely going to use it on Senpai EP2, which should be happening later this year. Cool. So I'm coming up to nearly 2.5 hours in the stream. I don't know if that's including my... the blue screen that happened earlier. So I'm gonna try and finish up nowish. So if you guys have any last questions, I will take them now. Otherwise, I'll be sort of trying to wrap up. Although I did say I was gonna wrap up half an hour ago, and I just didn't. What DAW do I use? Sony Acid Pro. I'm one of only four people on the world who uses it. Have you had any similar experiences to Anup Sastry with people taking your music and trying to sell it? I did was a, made aware of someone who was trying to make try to pass my music as his own, but I sent him an email saying that could you maybe not do this, and he deleted his Bandcamp. So, but nothing as overt as what happened to Anup with his latest EP. Favorite vegetable, broccoli, asparagus. Favorite comic, don't really read comics. Final question is, why deck human? Has anybody seen him? Well, he does have videos on his YouTube channel, and he does sort of, I don't know if he shows his face, but he's definitely in them, and I have spoken to him, so I think he is human. Favorite food, sushi. Do you plan to publish the tab book for your Senpai EP? Yes. I need to work on that a bit more. I've let that slip a little bit because of the new album, but yeah, that'll be happening. Cool. Favorite Final Fantasy? God. I'm going to piss everybody off and say 13. No, 13 was my favorite Final Fantasy. I haven't played them. I've heard that 9's very good. I need to play 9 once that comes to PC. So, I don't know. I quite like 7. I quite like 8. I've not played 6. I've not played 9. Played 10. Played bits of 12. Played 13. Oh my god, I can't even remember why I played 13. So yeah, probably 7 or 8 at the moment, although I do want to play 9. hashtag PC Master Race. So unless there's any other questions, I will be closing up. So thanks guys for attending. That makes it sound like class. Thanks guys for joining me for this webcast. Lots of really good questions, lots of really cool discussion. So yeah, it's been really good. Thanks to the guys at Wired Guitarist for setting this up. And hopefully, you know, maybe this becomes a thing with Wired Guitarist where they'll have more and more people on and, you know, being able to talk about different things. It was only planned to spend about an hour, but, you know, 2.5 hours, I guess, is close enough.
So yeah, thanks guys. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope you learned something. And hopefully you'll enjoy the new album when it comes out. So see you guys.